Good evening, everybody. Thank you so much for being here tonight. I'm Peter Steves, and it's my privilege to be the director of the DePaul Humanities Center. I'm pleased to welcome you to the Xenotext, The Art of Genes, A Life of Extremes, as we're joined tonight by three special guests who do something we regularly try to celebrate here at the Humanities Center: blur the lines between well-entrenched disciplines and fields of study until there is just the faintest trace of erasure. This evening, in fact, we're in the presence of masters. Within our trinity of guests, all are creators, starting with genetic matter and the rules of their own individual traditions, but building something anew. Some will challenge us to think about the art involved in science. Some will challenge us to think about the science involved in art. All will give us reason to rethink what it means to be living a life of creativity. In a few minutes, we'll begin with what is, at first glance, the most scientific of presentations, the work of NASA astrobiologist Jonathan Trent. But we'll find that, like the best scientists before him, Jonathan's imagination rivals the artists of his time, as he takes us into the world of extremophile life at the microbial level. We'll then turn to the music of the genes within us, sure to rival the music of the spheres above us, in the work of the School of the Art Institute of Chicago's Peter Gena, a man who knows how to sound out the science of life. And finally, we'll close with the author whose work brings us all here this evening and ties together extremophile microbiology and extreme poetry writing, the incredibly talented Christian Bök. I'll introduce each of our special guests more fully as the evening progresses, and eventually invite everyone on stage at the very end for a chance for you, the audience, to join in the conversation. But for the next few minutes, before we start in earnest, before the unzipping of the triple helix commences, I'd like to take a couple of minutes to think together about two topics that lie beneath all that we're about to explore this evening: the art of life and the nature of rules. Evolution is a series of accidents, nothing planned, nothing intended, and yet, like a Jackson Pollock canvas, natural selection's patterns of drips and drops have their own logic, their own rule-governed order. Romanesco broccoli grows in a Fibonacci golden spiral fractal. A cousin to the cauliflower, the plant buds and buds and buds, following a cruciferous drive of becoming over and over, again and again. Its growth is cousin to the same fractal pattern found in lightning bolts and snowflakes, physics as well as biology, taking up the halcyon call without a caller, stumbling into the same structure of life, beautiful, deadly, nurturing, sublime. 65 million years ago, ammonite marine cephalopods secreted and built up chambered spiral shells composed of intricate fractal curves, each growing in logarithmic spirals like a recursive sonnet that rhymes in on itself. Ancient, slow-swimming, near-ocean bottom dwellers, these sea poets created works of art that no one could see, invisible in the dim depths of the world's oceans, even to each other. Their shells, some of the most beautiful things that artists have ever shaped, were unperceived by the eyes of Cretaceous fishes and other beasts of the time in their dim world. What does it mean to have art without an audience? The history of philosophy, the history of aesthetics, struggles to make sense of such an idea. Without someone to experience art as art, can there even be an aesthetic object? The ammonites, floating 100 meters or more below the sea, possibly had eyes, but no one today knows what they looked like. Were they pinhole, complex, simple, probing, dreamy, or non-existent? The flesh never fossilizes. Only the canvas of our shells possibly remains across such vast stretches of time. Did the ammonites sense the sky incinerating and the water steam above them as their dinosaur neighbors vanished? Did they feel a new curtain of darkness fall on the waves as volcanic ash poured down and blocked the sun? Did they struggle in the end to take one final, or perhaps even one first, glance at each other as the spiral poetry of their shells crackled and began the long journey of turning to stone? The structures that build up life have their hidden splendors apart from those who witness them. The double twists of DNA that curl around each other like the tails of cats in love have meaning in their form as well as their content. G, A, T, and C fit together in a three-dimensional sculpture like musical notes on a staff written on a revolving barber's pole, like words in a poem that can be recited only when the poet stands before the audience and spins in place. Proteins, peptides, and strands of genetic material are not thought to be alive. The cell is generally considered to be the smallest unit of life, and we tend to see the true individual only at a higher level. This is a conceit, a prejudice of we who are relatively large. I am no more special than a cell, no more creative, no more alive. Even complexity is an accident and not the telos of evolution. And after all, what I am is merely a commune of living things. What it means to be me is the myriad life forms that make me up, making me up, the creatures that live on my eyelashes, coming out to clean them each night when I sleep, the microbes that live in my gut, doing all of my digestion for me. As biologist Lynn Margulis taught us, there's no such thing as a true individual. What we see as animals are partly just integrated sets of bacteria. Nearly all the DNA in our bodies belongs to microorganisms. They outnumber our own cells 9 to 1. They process the nutrients in our guts, produce the chemicals that trigger sleep, ferment the sweat on our skin and the glucose in our muscles. Humans are the acme of evolution, walking, talking microbial vats. If we cut up our human bodies, take any cell at random and perform a DNA test, there is a 90% chance that the DNA will be from some form of animal life that we do not consider human, let alone our own individual DNA. What it means to be a living thing is to be an artist's colony of smaller things. I am 10% Peter. I am Peter, but I am legion. We are making Peter at every moment. Sing my DNA, and you sing a song of others. Ask my DNA to write its history, and instead of an epic poem and a singular protagonist, you get billions of stories scratched out in foreign characters, billions of codonic scribes co-authorating, collaborating, becoming. Before DNA was discovered to be the molecule that passes along hereditary information, Erwin Schrödinger wrote a book imagining that whatever the medium of life turned out to be, the structure of that medium would have to be as important as the content of the information it carried. He proposed crystals, formally structured objects that carry out rudimentary self-replication, passing along a set of basic qualities from one generation to the next. He was wrong, of course, but poetically so. The structure of DNA is indeed part of its meaning. And interestingly, Christian Bök's first published collection of poetry is entitled Crystallography, a poetic science of crystals, and its format, as well as its content, contribute to its meaning as well. When Jonathan Trent looks at a microbe that can live in water so hot it would boil if not for the pressure of the sea, he sees in it the creative capacity to forge proteins that bend and warp in new structures, miniature nano-sculptures waiting to be assembled in his lab. When Peter Gena learns that Chopin had cystic fibrosis rather than consumption, as most people believe, he hears the genetic structure of the disease and composes a nocturne out of its pattern, ready to be assembled at his piano. And when Christian Bök sees the life of poetry and the poetry of life in one glance, he collapses art and science in the process. Indeed, the main thrust of much of Christian's work is to treat poetry as a science, to begin with a set of assumptions, embracing, even celebrating the fact that such assumptions might be absurd, but then, in his own words, to argue with rigor and logic from those fundamentals, as one would in any science. Christian is often using literature to make hypotheses about language, and then to test those hypotheses, he uses his poetry, as would any scientist toiling in his or her chosen field. Tonight, in the work of all three of our presenters, I hope that we can think together, like artists and scientists, about the ways in which these divisions might be arbitrary, and the way in which creativity is at the heart of their work, the heart of living, the art of being more than we think ourselves to be. Secondly, and toward this end, I propose that it's helpful to think together for just a moment about the nature of rules and limitations on our freedom. I am an anarchist, a communitarian anarchist, not the scary kind. And so it will seem strange even to me if I suggest that rules can be liberating. But it's all a question of which rules and which specific limitations one champions. What makes chess an interesting game to play is that there are very specific rules about the way in which the pieces move and the game unfolds. If one defines freedom as the right to do anything, freedom is actually impossible. To express one's freedom within the game of chess, it is a necessary precondition that there be rules to this game. If a pawn could move any number of spaces at any time in any direction, or if the definition of what it means to win could change mid-game, or if any opening move were allowed at all, such that if you and I were to play a game of chess, a legitimate opening move could be for me to set the board on fire, or douse you with chocolate syrup, or pull out my bagpipes and begin singing my way through the Taylor Swift song catalog until you left the room, we could have an interesting evening together, but we couldn't play chess. Chaos and anarchy are not the same thing. The right set of rules can allow us to express our freedom rather than inhibit it. The right restrictions can be liberating. Jonathan Trent accepts the ways that proteins can bend and twist, and then he works within those possible topologies to create new structures that have never existed before. Peter Gena stares down the limitations of G, A, T, and C, and though he cannot change the number of nucleotides in a strand of DNA, he can think beyond the possibility of mere translation into four single notes, and thus come to play something structured, newly complicated, and free. And Christian Bök's medium of poetry comes, of course, with a long tradition of limitations built in. The sonnet, the villanelle, the haiku, each is an attempt to enforce rules on the writer in order to create greater opportunities for freedom. But Christian, he takes it further. When he wrote Eunoia, a book in which five chapters contain words restricting to using only one vowel, that is, there's a chapter in which A is the only vowel to appear in any word, and then chapters for E, I, O, and U as well. It was, again in his words, to excise all romantic metaphors of inspiration from his poetry. But it was also to interrogate language, to see just what could be done creatively as the shackles of the rules grew heavier. One of the reasons that I'm strict with my students about learning the rules of punctuation, even, is because their mastery of these rules will allow them greater creativity and expression within the language. Suppose I were to say to you in writing that I love my parents, Jay-Z and Beyoncé. As it stands, this sentence suggests that Jay-Z and Beyoncé are my parents. I can tell you tonight that they are, alas, not. The addition of a second comma, the Oxford comma as it's often called, keeps us from such misunderstandings. You now know that I love three things. I love my parents, I love Jay-Z, and I love Beyoncé. A classic example of the importance of this comma, which I recall my English professor Charles Klingler first telling me in 1985, though that seems like yesterday, is the poem Stopping by Woods on a Snowy Evening by Robert Frost. Toward the end of the poem, before we learn that Frost has miles to go before he sleeps, we get the line, "These woods are lovely, dark and deep." If we trust Frost, trust him enough to know that he knows he is supposed to use that second serial Oxford comma when listing three things, then we're free to assume that he's leaving this comma out purposefully. And this changes the meaning of the sentence. Frost is saying that the woods are lovely precisely because they have two qualities. They're dark and they're deep. It's their darkness and depth that constitute their loveliness. The loveliness is not merely a third quality that the woods have. If the sentence had read, "These woods are lovely, dark, and deep," then we would have known that Frost thinks the woods have three qualities. If we cannot trust the author when we encounter the sentence, then we can't really be sure of the meaning. Getting rid of the rule blunts the language and allows us to do less with it. That is, we have less freedom when this rule disappears, more freedom when we have the rule. And it's also the case that trust plays a major role in communication, as it always must. Without trust in the poet, we do not understand Frost. Without trust in everyday speech, your words can mean nothing to me. Science is, at its heart, a set of assumptions about the world and a set of rules that restrict the ways in which knowledge can be gained of that world. Assumptions plus rules equal ideology. Tonight, as we investigate language, the world, art, microbes, and what it means to be the Xeno in our own texts, I wish to celebrate some of the restrictions that are upon us, we who are many, we who sing in our chains like the sea. And so, to begin unencumbered by that which encumbers us, it's my pleasure to welcome our first speaker. Jonathan Trent is a NASA scientist, but he is, in important ways, truly a Renaissance man, a careful thinker about whatever topic it is toward which he happens to be aiming his intellect and his creativity. 13 years ago, Jonathan invited me to the NASA Ames Research Center, where he works as part of the Astrobiology Institute. And the days that I spent with Jonathan, his colleagues, and a small group of a dozen or so scientists from around the world thinking about quantum theory and the origin of life on Earth remains a touchstone for me about what can be accomplished and what excitement can be generated in an interdisciplinary setting when committed people are gathered to focus on one of the big questions. I recall even that a couple of days into the workshop, Jonathan was scheduled to give his main presentation to the group. But rather than offer us what he had prepared earlier, he stayed up the night before and completely reworked his ideas and innovations based on the discussion that had closed our preceding evening. It was an inspiring moment for what it means to be in true conversation as a thinking community. Jonathan's enthusiasm is contagious, his creativity a model for us all. As we're here this evening to think about the relationship between genetic science and genetic art, creativity seems an appropriate place to begin, because the very best scientists and the very best artists are all about creativity, pushing their creative impulses in new ways and bringing things together that might not have been imagined before. Jonathan's background is in microbiology, especially the microbiology of extremophile life, the sort of life that finds a way to keep on living even in the midst of inhospitable conditions. With degrees and affiliations from such places as Scripps Institution of Oceanography, the Max Planck Institute for Biochemistry, the University of Copenhagen, University of Paris at Marseille, the Boyer Center for Molecular Medicine at Yale Medical School, the Argonne National Laboratory, Jonathan divides his time these days among his position at NASA, his adjunct professorship of biomolecular engineering at UC Santa Cruz, and his directorship of the Omega Global Initiative. The latter is Jonathan's plan to solve the energy and environmental crisis, a revolutionary offshore project that combines algae cultivation for biofuel, wastewater treatment, and carbon capture, along with electricity and heat generation by solar energy, drinking water produced by osmosis, and food production by aquaculture. I encourage you to learn more about the project at omegaglobal.org later tonight. But for now, I've asked Jonathan to speak to us about the sort of life that he's been studying for so long, the extremophiles that outwit nature and human common sense at every turn. They live in the bone-dry Atacama Desert of South America, in near boiling water around black smokers at the deepest ocean trenches, in ice a half mile below the surface in Antarctica, and perhaps on other planets. To get us started properly now, I'm very pleased to introduce to you extremophile, NASA scientist, Renaissance thinker, Jonathan Trent.
Good evening. It's a hard act to follow. That was a wonderful presentation. So, some years ago, I lived in Chicago, and this time of year, it was very special. When Peter invited me, it was really a pleasure to come back to Chicago and see Chicago in this transition period, this period that was spring, and be part of a lecture series that includes the three of us all working on the molecular level. It occurred to me that when we think about the situation we're in here in spring, and we think about this type of landscape, there's the question of wood. And wood, for me as a biologist, means form and function. I can think about trees in terms of how the trees grow. What are the types of trees and the mechanisms for their life? What does it mean to be photosynthetic? How do they move water? How do they get energy from the sun? And what are they doing to turn CO2 into biomass. We can name them. At the same time, we can study their systems and their subsystems and all the different scales that exist. But it occurred to me in the context of what we're doing, we have to think about scale. But we also have to think about not only what a biologist and a scientist's worldview is, but what's a technologist's worldview? That same tree to a technologist is basically a building material. That technologist worries about wood from the standpoint of what is its bending modulus and its compression strength? What can it be used for in terms of building? How is it useful? But then there's the question of the artist. The artist looks at wood with a very different eye. The artist sees wood also as a building material, but a building material where you can capture concepts, where you can freeze a notion and bring it to life again, but in wood. So wood is a material with which the artist works. I want to ponder with you the concepts of biology, technology, and the other speakers are going to focus on the art. They are not working with wood, and I, as a technologist and a biologist, have not just worked with biological materials, but we've looked at a very special scale. The scale is called the nanoscale. And this nanoscale for biologists, technologists, and artists is something special. Let me teach you a little bit about the nanoscale. On this scale, shown here, 10 to the 8th nanometers is about 100 million nanometers. It's about 4 inches. If you think about that scale, that's about where our eyes, the size of our eyes, between 10 to the 7th and 10 to the 8th nanometers. A mosquito is at 10 to the 6th nanometers. A human hair is 100,000 nanometers. Below the size of human hair, we start seeing cells, the complex cells that make up our bodies, or the very special small cells that are the most common organisms on the Earth and that have been here for the longest time, bacterial cells. They're 1 micron, which makes them about 10 to the 3rd nanometers, 1,000 nanometers. Viruses are below 100 nanometers in general. Proteins are about 10 nanometers. A strand of DNA is about 1 nanometer in diameter. That is, its width can be very long. Water molecules are sub-nanometer, and then we come to atoms. If we look at that in terms of where the technologists are right now, we can think of it in where our Pentium microprocessors are. On the same scale, we put integrated circuits, interconnects that make up our computers. Our transistors are already in the less than 100 nanometer scale. Some of them are 50 nanometers, even down to 35 nanometers. And the structures that make up the interconnects and the transistors, the silicon substrates, are all in the 1 nanometer, almost atomic level. When we talk about nanotechnology, we're talking about the nanomaterials, the structures like nanotubes made of carbon and dendrimers and nanopores, quantum dots and nanoshells or nanoparticles, all below 100 nanometers in size. But what does this mean? It's very difficult for us to grasp the concept. We got down to the width of a human hair and we're all sort of together. But when we get below that, our minds sort of boggle. So let's try to get some visualization. So let's zoom in on this man's hand and look at the hair on the back of his hand. At this magnification, you can see the hair, and we're going to enlarge the hair, and at this magnification, this is a yeast cell, and this is a bacterial cell. So this is the cell that's 1,000 nanometers. Now, if you look at this in the context of bacteria and yeast, or a red blood cell, or a white blood cell, a sperm cell, a skin cell or a muscle cell, or even a nerve cell, the scale of living things is really, really different. Remember, on the nanoscale, the bacteria are here at 1,000 nanometers, 1 micron. And here we are in the realm that we're more familiar with. But what we're going to be talking about is the nanoscale below the 100 nanometers, size of viruses, actual proteins and molecules. Because if we look again at that hair on the back of your hand and we zoom into that hair and we look at the yeast cell that's here, we notice that there's another yeast cell here. And there's not only one bacteria on this hair, but there are hundreds of bacteria. In fact, just for your knowledge, there are 10 times more bacterial cells on your body than there are human cells, whether you had a shower this morning or not. And the genomic material of the microbes living on our bodies is about 100 times that of the human genome. So we're now talking about communities, ecologies of living things, that as Peter mentioned in his beautiful intro lecture, that those organisms are critical for our well-being. The so-called microbiome is part of who we are, very much so. Let's talk about these bacterial cells. Think about them from a technologist's point of view. It's kind of a living machine, if you will. And all the components of that machine are contained within that box. Proteins, ribosomes, DNA and RNA, all the different enzymes that make the system work. And let's look inside of those boxes. In fact, if we look at this organism as a series of 100 nanometer cubes, and you look at this region of the cell, you notice that there is this red material, which is fatty material called lipids. It makes up the cell surrounding structure. And inside the cell, there are these blue blobs, which are proteins, and yellow things, which are called ribosomes, made up of RNA mostly. And then there's this so-called DNA, which you've heard so much about, which is a purple rope-like structure. If we analyze this cell, we realize that it's mostly water. 70% of this cell is a squashy cell, is water. Of the remaining 30%, half of that is protein, the blue blobs I mentioned before. 6% is RNA, which is the yellow structures as well as the little green structures. So the little 3% miscellaneous stuff, 3% carbohydrate, 2% is the lipid red material around the outside of the cell, and only 1% of the cell volume is DNA. The central dogma of molecular biology is that DNA makes RNA, makes proteins, and proteins help to stabilize and replicate the DNA. And what you're going to be hearing from the other speakers this evening are interesting ideas about how the DNA and the proteins can be turned into more humanized and artistic things. But let's think about this DNA. This cell that I'm showing here, it could as well be a cell called E. coli or Escherichia coli. Its DNA has been completely sequenced. We know all the base pairs that make it up. We know the alphabet that this organism is made up of, the whole encyclopedia for all of the proteins and all of the structure. There's 5 million base pairs in this organism's DNA. Its DNA structure, which is shown here as a sort of stranded area, is about 1.6 millimeters in length for an organism that's 1 micron. That means its DNA is 1,000 times longer than the length of the cell. So let's think about that. So the human body has got an intestine that's about 25 feet long, right? So depending on how long you are, that's about 4 or 5 times taller, longer than you are tall. This DNA inside this organism is 1,000 times longer, and it's wrapped around structures of proteins, and it's being used by the cell. So the DNA in this organism codes for known about 4,500 proteins, but there are about 16,000 different particular structures that this material is somehow transferring the information for. The proteins that are being made are being made by a molecular machine called a ribosome, which we now understand is structured down to very high resolution, and this is just an artist's conception. But the DNA is being made into an RNA strand, and the RNA is being translated by this structure into a string of amino acid that spontaneously folds into a protein. So what's wrong with this picture? What's wrong with this picture is that it's static. In fact, It's a bit like me showing you this picture, but we know that this is just a still picture of a very active process, because this organism is writhing, the inside is constantly moving. The membrane around the outside of the cell is moving around like a soap bubble. The DNA is being replicated into, is being transcribed into RNA at a rate of 70 nucleotides a second. And then the RNA is being translated to proteins at a rate of 40 codons per second. Imagine, count to 70 in 1 second. I dare you, or I defy you. I mean, but that's the process that's going on in the cell. And everything is moving. A protein inside the cell moves there and back in 1 second. The whole structure is moving. Just as this wave, you understand, is moving, when we see static pictures of cells, we don't understand that they're actually moving. So in this central dogma, which is really just a line drawing, we as biologists are trying to understand the complexity of this living system, which is unlike any machine we've ever known. But let's think about this living system as a technologist. Let's think about what we might do as a nanotechnologist. We could use this organism with all of its components and its ability to replicate and make structures. We can use viruses like these viruses that affect bacterial cells, or this is the tobacco mosaic virus, and this is the HIV virus. These are organisms, or these are structures that require living things to replicate. But what can we use within this living system? We can take advantage of the fact that it somehow self-assembles. That in addition to self-assembly, it has molecular recognition. It adapts its structures through a process of evolution, which we can direct. Those adaptations not only can be structural, but they can be functional. And we can induce non-biological structure and organization, which I'm going to talk about a lot more. And then we can look at the full potential of biology. That is to say, we don't have to restrict ourselves to bacteria like E. coli that live in our guts, but rather we can do, as Peter suggested I've been doing for years, we can be going to places that are out of the ordinary and looking for life in unexpected places, looking for extremophiles. So here we are hiking the volcano on the peninsula of Kamchatka in the Russian Far East. And here inside the caldera, the air stinks of rotten eggs from hydrogen sulfide. And it's cold. The glacier here is running into the hot spring. And you can see my partner's hammer, our Russian guide, failed to tell us exactly what the conditions would be like here. I'm taking a sample of liquid from the volcano that's at pH 2, which means it's very acidic, at a temperature of about 90 degrees. Do you think anything lives there? Do you think an organism can live in these types of incredibly harsh places? Actually, our Russian guide told us that one year they took a student group up there, and one of the students had slipped and fallen into this hot spring, and the only thing they could recover to bring home to his parents was one of his leg bones. So sulfuric acid seems to be incredibly harsh, and yet we isolate organisms like this organism, Sophilobus japonti, which are called thermoacidophiles, meaning they are loving acid and loving high temperatures. So when I have my biologist hat on, I ask the question, how in the world does this organism live there? And I've studied the organism's ability to synthesize certain proteins, and indeed it makes one really amazing protein structure where in the electron microscope you can see the individual proteins which spontaneously form a ring structure that looks like this. And this is a scale of 5 nanometers, so this is about 17 nanometers across. And this protein structure was amazing because when I, as a postdoc in Germany, at Yale Medical School, not in Germany, I worked for a long time on this protein, but when I got to Yale Medical School, I sequenced the gene for this protein, and it turned out to be related to a human protein. It turned out to be related to a yeast protein and a human protein, and only very distantly related to the bacterial proteins. And I published this paper in a very prestigious scientific journal called Nature, and I had a cover on the issue, and it was a really big deal. And then I discovered that this protein was related to this thing called a molecular chaperone, which is a very, very popular idea in the scientific community, but I discovered that this theory was wrong. And it was wrong, barely compellingly wrong. In fact, it was Julian Huxley who said that the great tragedy of science is that the slaying of beautiful hypotheses by ugly facts. And so we had found that this protein was clearly related structurally to all of the molecules called molecular chaperones, but the concept that molecules or that proteins need chaperones was just fundamentally wrong. So what happens in the scientific community when you're a member of a scientific community working on molecular chaperones and you get all these great data and you say, hey, wait, look, I discovered that this theory is wrong and here's all the reason I think it's wrong. You know, my advisor when I was a graduate student had a sign over his desk and it said, scientists don't solve problems, they colonize problems. Turns out in peer review, when you have an anomalous idea, that the colony throws you out. But anyway, it was good for me that I think if I ever get a Nobel Prize, it'll be for this work that I published long ago and proved that this theory of molecular chaperones is wrong. But for now, I'm a total outsider. But that's okay, because I'm not just a biologist, I'm also a technologist. And we saw the structure of this protein, and the structure of the individual protein looks like this, where each of these balls represents an amino acid, and it spontaneously assembles into this beautiful ring structure, which then sits on top of another ring to make a double ring structure that inside you has an equatorial domain and has an apical domain. And then on the end view, you see that it has this really beach ball-like structure. And then what we did is we looked at these structures and we found that we could, under certain conditions with pure protein in a very non-biological condition, the proteins form chains. And those chains form big, interesting aggregates. Under other conditions, we could get the ring proteins to form these amazing arrays of individual proteins on a surface. So what can you do with these individual ring proteins that spontaneously form these big chains? Well, we've genetically modified them so they formed individual strains that could get many, many hundreds and thousands of proteins long. And then we metallized them and made them into nanowires. We also worked on this amazing ability of these protein rings to align side by side to form these types of two-dimensional crystalline structures that we could make in a completely flawless way. We then genetically modified the individual protein by adding a structure that allowed us to make a ring that had this very sticky element to it. And that sticky element would then allow us to assemble these proteins into a two-dimensional crystal, and then throw metal particles at them, and they would stick to that particular sticky element. And this allowed us, you can see in the electron microscope, to stick metals to the top and bottom, or just to the top of these proteins. And so we could make a two-dimensional array, and we could arrange metal particles on the surface. And in fact, we did that, and we built these types of metal arrays of individual protein structures that were organized and templated on this structure. So why is this interesting? The hard drive in a computer right now is made up of a metal which is magnetic, and it's sputter-coated onto the surface with about 8 nanometer structures, but in order to make information storage on this, you have to average over about 100 of these 8 nanometer structures in order to get a bit of information stored on your hard drive. People had said that the future of storing data was to make a magnetic array of individual particles that was perfectly organized. And we did that. We put magnetic particles onto these protein template, and then we burned away the protein like a lost wax experiment. And by doing that and putting this onto a platter, we could store 1.5 terabits of information per inch squared. And it was all mediated by a protein. But let's go on, let's talk about biology and technology and how this might be inspiring other forms of what we do and think about as artists.
ABC News World Headquarters in New York. This is World News Tonight with Peter Jennings.
When we come back, our final item on the broadcast tonight, searching this world's most hostile environment for clues to alien life. So finally, from us, searching for extraterrestrial life. It's become a very serious area of study. There's even a name for it now, astrobiology. Many scientists actually believe that man may soon discover some form of alien life, and the hunt is on here as well as there. Here's ABC's Jack Smith.
Are we alone in the universe? For years, astronomers have been listening to the heavens with radio telescopes for the answer. Now, NASA scientists are trying something new, searching here on Earth for what they call extremophiles, life forms that manage to survive in extreme environments. If they can make it in the toughest conditions found on this planet, they might be able to make it anywhere.
What is it that an organism does to adapt itself to live in boiling sulfuric acid or above, or to live in ice or even well below the freezing point of water?
NASA scientists are diving under the polar ice, peering into the ocean vents of volcanoes, and lowering probes into the boiling geysers of Yellowstone, looking for hitherto undiscovered forms of life. Why?
We want to understand what the capabilities are for life here, so we have a more rational way of approaching the search for life on other planets.
And if it is ever found, alien life probably will not look like this, the Hollywood version, but rather like what one sees under a microscope.
Primarily microbial life forms.
We have liftoff of NASA's Mars Climate Orbiter.
If there is life on another planet, it's thought the nearest place would be Mars.
Mars, being a smaller target, may have had less of the bombardment that went on in the early development of the solar system, and so that life may have evolved there and been transported to here. If there was one other example in our own solar system, so then the possibilities for life existing in other worlds and other solar systems just becomes that much more believable.
In other words, we may not be alone.
We may not be alone.
We may not be alone. I showed that video just so you can see what aging does to people. That was 15 years ago when I first started working at NASA. But since then, I've been looking at Mars quite a lot. I've been studying the possibility that there could be microbial life on Mars and considering the possibility of what we could do to find out about life on Mars. The interesting thing now is I've been working for NASA for 17 years, and during that time we've had three scientific missions that have put rovers on the surface. This is the landing of Curiosity that happened on August 2012. What you may or may not know is that Mars is an incredibly cold, dry place. These are the first images that came back from Curiosity in 2012 when it turned his camera on to survey the desolate, dry, cold environment that is Mars. The average temperatures on Mars are minus 80 degrees Fahrenheit. The warmest day will be about 70 degrees at the equator, and that night will go down to minus 103. The coldest days are minus 185 degrees. The rover has collected amazing data, and if we're on Mars to find out about what the conditions are there and the science of the surface of Mars, even the biology of Mars, this is more than adequate. We certainly don't need to send people there. But don't tell NASA I said that, because NASA is still planning to send people to Mars by about the year 2030. In fact, we have plans at NASA to send people to the red planet, and we know what it'll be like when they get there. There's certainly no breathable atmosphere on Mars. The atmospheric composition is mostly CO2. There's about 96% CO2. There's a little bit of argon. There's a little bit of nitrogen. There's 0.14% oxygen. The Earth's atmosphere is 21% oxygen, which we are happy to breathe. So if we send people to Mars and we try to envision putting them in some kind of a colony there, they would be totally reliant on the quality of their suit. Because not only is there no usable water, that is water on Mars boils at 40 degrees Fahrenheit. It boils, right? Water here boils at 212 degrees Fahrenheit. On Mars, it boils at 40 degrees. What does that mean? Well, that means if this guy had a garment malfunction and he lost pressure in his suit, all the liquid in his body would boil. He would, of course, freeze to death. He would die from radiation damage, and the dust on Mars is covered in a toxic substance called perchlorate. So Mars is not a great place for people. And besides, if we sent people to Mars, they would mostly be taking care of rovers that don't really care about all these horrible things. But Mars is an interesting place to think about. And in fact, I wanted to end my presentation by telling you about another thing that we're celebrating this evening. And it was shown very well in the movie The Martian. The Martian movie is not very believable in terms of the actual activity. If you haven't seen the movie, it's basically about an expedition to Mars in the future in which there's a terrible dust storm that's pretty much artistic license, because dust storms on Mars with such a thin atmosphere don't actually behave like they did in the movie, but that's okay. This guy gets blown away and they have to take off and they leave him behind and they assume that he was dead, but he's alive. And the movie was really a celebration. It was a celebration. There must be some kind
of way out of here. Okay, so let's do it. I have enough food to last for 50 days.
He's going to starve to death long before we can help.
So I'm going to have to science the shit out of this.
He's 50 million miles away from home. He's totally alone. What the hell is he thinking right now?
I am the greatest botanist on this planet.
He was, in fact, the greatest botanist on the planet. And in fact, what the movie is about is a celebration of human ingenuity and a celebration of that ingenuity in the face of incredible difficulties. On a planet where resources were terribly limiting, he had to figure out how to get food, water, and energy to stay alive. And it really was a matter of life and death. So this celebration of ingenuity, we all appreciate. In fact, if we look at this picture carefully, you notice from this image from Mars that was taken by Spirit on the surface, one of the other rovers, that tiny blue dot, or as Carl Sagan might have described it, that pale blue dot is us. And we now are in a position where our planet is becoming resource limited, and we are going to have to use that same ingenuity and creativity to figure out how to get food, water, and energy. Well, I'm happy to say that we've been working on this for the last 8 years, and we have a project we call Omega, and as Peter mentioned, you can look this up on the internet. It's something that we think we've got a way to solve some of these serious problems with a population that's totally out of hand, it's at 7 billion going to 9 billion by 2050. But I invite you to look up the Omega Project on the internet or come and ask me after the presentations. But we talked today now about our using biology and biological inspiration. It goes back to our ancient ancestors, and now we're using biological systems like proteins to create structures. This is a celebration of ingenuity in the form of biotech. The biotechnology that allows us to manipulate the genes that code for proteins, and that proteins are changed to do things by self-assembly, molecular recognition, and genetic engineering. It's not totally different than what we've done transforming lumber into beautiful structures, but it is along the same lines of creativity. And now I'm inviting Peter back to talk about the next speakers, and I'll end here.
That was amazing, Jonathan. Thank you so much. So we move away from the extremes of life for the next few minutes to consider a way in which the genetic programming of all life is always already an art. Peter Gena is a talented and innovative composer who has, since 1983, been a professor at the School of the Art Institute of Chicago, where he teaches electronic and computer music, music history, computer programming, and various other interdisciplinary courses. Influenced by and interested in such figures as John Cage and Robert Rauschenberg, Peter's publishing includes such important volumes as The John Cage Reader, released in 1983 to celebrate Cage's 70th birthday. And the breadth of his composing has been matched only by its creativity and innovation. As a pianist, he's performed his work and that of others around the world, and his compositions of various media, including instrumental, electronic, and computer-generated works, have been presented extensively in North and South America, Europe, Asia, and Australia. More than 20 years ago, really at the vanguard of this sort of work, Peter was already doing such things as translating genetics into art by, for example, converting DNA sequences by means of an algorithm and playing them on a DNA mixer, which read the code linearly, modeling the performance on ribosomes themselves, which read codons for amino acid conversion, transversing the messenger RNA and mixing multiple sequences simultaneously. I think you'll get to see a bit of that, in fact, in a moment. In one of Peter's most celebrated pieces, working with a couple of his colleagues, a synthetic gene was created that coded a sentence from the biblical book of Genesis: "Let man have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over every living thing that moves upon the earth." This was then converted into music, with the added bonus that the DNA mixer mutated the gene, changing a different DNA signifier roughly every 100,000 base pairs, with remote users being allowed to shine UV lights on the plasmid, causing the protein in the bacteria to fluoresce, and controlling the rate of the mutations, the timbral changes in the music, and the tempo of the sequence. The question of human dominion was shown, talked about, and deconstructed all in one fascinating artistic moment. Over the years, Peter's work has been performed around the world, has been choreographed for dance performance by the New York City Ballet, and has generally changed the conversation about how we think of music. And tonight, he's here to keep that conversation going with us. It's my pleasure to introduce to you Professor Peter Gena.
Brings up the fact that the misconception about John Cage is a lot of people think that anything goes. And his work, the idea of anything goes only happens when you have nothing to assume. So his work, those of us who knew him and anybody who really studied him knows that there's a lot of self-discipline in his process and his work. And the idea of what you said about anarchy with form, was primarily with him, with his self-discipline, is found throughout. Okay, well, this work came as a result of a friendship. Now, as I call this person my best friend, who is a distinguished geneticist, who was in Chicago, was the chief geneticist at Illinois Masonic, is also a pediatrician. But now he is the vice president of genetics at Quest Diagnostics, in San Juan Capistrano, California. His name is Dr. Charles Strom, and he's known for his work in pre-implantation. He is probably the only geneticist who was an honorary member of the American Gynecological Society because of all the work he's done with embryos. And he's done forensic genetics. I mean, any pro basketball player who signed a contract and was accused by someone of having their baby, he would fly out and do the DNA testing. And he's also solved crimes, and he's written extensively that. Well, anyway, to make a long story short, it turns out he lived a block away from me, and I met him because he was bringing his son to my wife, who teaches violin, and then we started talking, and he said, "Why don't you do DNA? Why don't we do DNA music?" I said, fine, but I don't know a thing about it. Now, I've done brainwave music in the 70s in California when some kind of spaced out bioengineer came over, and the next day brought in all this equipment, and we would hook ourselves up and just meditate, and, you know, bring our alphas up and do that. And when I got here, when I took a job at Northwestern initially to move to Chicago, I couldn't find anybody really that would pursue it with me. Full disclosure, we usually talk about this together. I don't know anything about biology. What I will do, though, fortunately, is we have Jonathan here. I may have to any questions about biology, we can defer to him, and I'm sure I'm going to be saying things that are wrong, but we'll do the best we can. So, the idea of using DNA, sorry, the idea of using DNA is one that we had to think about a little bit. There are so many different ways to do it, and it's a subjective thing. There's no objective way. There's no way of saying this is the correct, this is the way this stuff would sound, you know. This is the way, this is the only way that you could possibly realize it. Of course not. There are things as simple as just taking the A, T, C, and G of the nucleobases in the bottom. You see the A, T, C, and C and G there, and figuring out a way of making a note for T and play four notes throughout. You know, I didn't think, but my friend, being the kind of scientist that he was, thought, well, you know, we talked about that, so we're not going to do something that simple. He said, well, why don't we use other properties? So here, I think most of you are familiar with this. The base pairs are the individual letters in the helix, and in the helix, the G's bond with C on the other, and C with G and A and T, so there's a hydrogen bonding. Three at a time, they produce amino acids called codons. So first I wrote a program. I said, where are we going to get this stuff? He said, well, and then this was in the 90s. There were DVDs or CDs that had a lot of different genomes on, you know. So he got me in touch with that. But the DNA would not be in codons. It would be absolute letter by letter. So I wrote a program that looked for what we call a start codon. And once it found that, went and took three at a time until it found the stop codon. Then I was able to isolate the individual genes, okay? So now, just one thing to be clear about is I don't take your DNA and make your music. We're dealing with genes that we all have. If you're healthy, my blood cells are the same as yours or anybody else's, okay? This ancestry.com thing where you're supposed to be able to find you're a third German and a fourth Italian, and it's all, you know, by sending a swab of your DNA, it doesn't really make a lot of sense, does it? I don't know if they've discovered yet the DNA that determines the length of your nose. I mean, we're not doing that. We're doing the known cells of the genome and the diseases. And as Jonathan pointed out, the human body probably has how many billions of DNA that we don't even know what it does, and we know that there are even like amoebas, right, that have tons of DNA for such a simple structure. You know, it's all historic, right? Yeah.
2/3 of the genes in E. coli come from other organisms.
Right. Yeah. So it would make sense. There's a certain amount in the body, like as I think you were saying, right? So we're dealing with the known stuff, okay? So how do I do this? How do I make a pitch out of these codons? Okay, the first thing to know is that the codons, as was said, produce amino acids, which produce the proteins. We made up this physio-musical conversion. Now, I have to tell you again, this is not the only way it we can do it. I'm not saying that the way we're doing it is the proper way. But once we did it this way, I decided we'd stick with the system, because if you're going to read different strands of different DNA, different genomes and things, different DNA cells, you've got to, if you want to hear it, see the difference between them, you can't keep changing the rules, right? And besides, we're talking about life here, you know, with life you don't want to fool around with the score too much, right? So the way we did frequency is we used the pKa, which is the acidity, and then we did the hydrogen bonding, and then a constant of the hydrogen bonds. This is kind of to keep the frequency within the range of the piano or the symphony or whatever. And I couldn't really decide if high acidity meant a higher pitch or a lower pitch, or if a low acidity meant a lower higher pitch. So I have two formulas that it would pick equally from. It would either make it use the acidity to pick to make the pitch higher, the higher number of pKa to pKa to make a higher pitch, and the lower number low pitch, or the lower number making a higher pitch, and vice versa. Okay, and duration we did a similar. We figured out a similar thing. We used it's much simpler. We used the pKa, the molecular weight of the amino acid, and the sum of hydrogen bonds, and then there's a tempo constant to make the ratio. You have to have you want to keep it in within a reasonable length, the rhythms, as it were. Okay, and then for intensities, we use sound the pressure levels, which would go from 0 to 127, which corresponds to MIDI code, okay? And then we would use a code on melting temperature. So then what we would create were these, I created the table after I dissected the codons from the straight letters, and we, you can see on top of the stop genes, those are what you look for, starting to stop, to see where the gene starts. And then we have these various numbers, the pKa and the hydrogen binding and all that stuff. Okay. This is an old example of the ribosomes. How old could this be, Jonathan? I don't know, from an electron microscope. But what I was fascinated about the ribosomes is what Jonathan said, is that they take the messenger, the DNA produces the messenger RNA in the cell, and then they jump on it and they read this linearly. I didn't realize, I wasn't sure if they all read it at the same speed.
No, they're going different speeds.
That's good. I mean, thank goodness, how boring would that be for our body and for the music? So we had this option, you know, so maybe a ribosome would sit on one amino acid longer than the next element. But we had these options. So this, I was fascinated by the fact that it's linear. So I thought, well, what about you, how do we produce this stuff? Why don't we mix DNA? I decided, well, I'll start with these six, we have six channels of music at the same time, okay? I would make it into an installation where we have drop-down menus which have various genes in them, okay? That you could pick and then play, and then you could set, it would give you the length, and then you could set where the ribosome happens to be. Since there's not a conductor that tells all your cells, okay, start at the downbeat, they're all playing at different places, right? You could then pick up wherever the ribosomes are. It'd be crazy to, right? And this is happening billions. You know, we have this wonderful polyphony in our bodies that we should try to tap. Okay, and then when left to its own devices, it's sort of like a jukebox. It will pick from your favorites from here. So you can see we have, we have anything from the red blood cells, which was one of the first ones I've done. We'll play some of that. A botulism, which is a popular after dinner room. Believe me, I did play it after a luncheon. Collagen, and then, how many rhinoviruses are there? Millions, right? So we picked 1, 2, and 14. Cystic fibrosis, which I did use with the Chopin thing. Adolescent HIV, HPV, which has become much more popular since I did this in my life. Liver. You know, various things, measles, rubella, and then these are the sex genes, the male sex genes, which I will talk about in a minute. That was another installation. So let's see the best way, uh,
would probably be from, so take a second, and if I could go back here and bring up this up, the actual thing. So as I said, I'm gonna need to move this over here. As I said, you could go on and you could either select from these, a drop-down menu. You can, and do the each time, you can decide how many channels you wanna play at once, because remember, these billions of these things are going on at once in any given cell, right? A given number of cells. So you can do that, or you could select, your favorites. And then, of course, you could pick a tempo. Because who's to say how fast this stuff is? And, I mean, we're not going to go as fast as it probably really happens, otherwise it's just blurred, right? So let's say we do one of these, let's see. Changes the, I'll bring it up in a minute. So it's playing the cystic fibrosis mutation, and there are just three of them starting at different times. Okay. And then, if you wanted to do a user mix, you just press user mix, and you go through here and you pick the ones you want. Let's do a little. Let's do a liver. Let's do. Let's throw in one of the blood cells, red blood cells. You get the idea, right? Let's throw in collagen. Do a little of the. Dehydrotestosterone, which I will play for you later, and let's pick a tempo. And we can initialize the ribosomes wherever, they don't have to start at one, as I said, right? And then we could go ahead and play the thing. Now, what it does, you probably ask, well, how do you get those sounds? The sounds come, basically, I have a series of electronic sounds, and there are eight classes of amino acids, then it'll pick eight different electronic synthesized sounds for the piece. And it won't necessarily pick the same sounds each time you do something. Okay? That's another surprise there. But the idea of the timbres then come from if the codon is in a certain class of amino acid, then they are, those that are in the same class will have the same timbre. Okay. All right. I think so. We're gonna move along here back to PowerPoints. Okay, let's move on. Just to show you, this is a program object code language called Max MSP. It was named. How many of you are musicians here? You know it? Anybody work with it? No. It's been around since the early '90s. I was the first one to teach it at the School of the Art Institute. A friend of mine, a very famous musician from Chicago, actually, George Lewis, was at EARCOM, and he brought back a beta version, because I hired him to teach a couple of courses at the school, and he said, here, here's a beta version of this thing. And so I was on sabbatical, I worked with it, and then I taught a class on it the next semester. And all of this is that you can, it's almost like an analog synthesizer. You can see your logic through patch chords. Now, this is a little bit overwhelming, but just to show you that these things involve extensive programming. Some of the simpler things are, you've got to have a scheduler. When you're dealing with events, you've got to schedule it, right? So you need a rhythmic buffer. You got to take account what the rhythms are, because each time it picks us a codon, it's going to pick a different rhythm. So you have to be able to count how long that rhythm plays out for, so you can go to the next one. And then, so you have the processor, and you have then the play, which uses the processor, and then you have
Each channel has a way of making the notes, which is down here.
Okay, that's quick. And then, this is a virtual mixer. Okay, virtual audio mixer. Easy enough. I mean, not easy enough, but I mean, it's all done with this program. So I use nothing outside of the computer, right? In the early days of electronic music, you would have something like this on a console that's 60 channels, and they still use them in the studio. So what happens here is that when the loudness is picked, it then automatically sets the loudness of the mixer. Okay, and then they mix down to two. You can mix them to 5.1 or whatever. You know, I have a piece or two in 5.1 surround. Okay, so a typical early installation would look like this, with the old-fashioned screen, the speakers. If you can't see it, but in the center here, there is there's a mouse, so you can pick stuff like I just did. And then, just for the, for the scholars, I have the DNA sequences up here, okay? So, and here's a later one, not much later, I did in Glasgow in 2001, with a user here. And there's the DNA for your perusal there. Okay. So now we're gonna start with this. This is one of the first pieces we did. The red blood cells. These five. Okay. And these are the five we use. I don't know much about them, but I can tell you that I understand that, we were talking about mutations, Peter, but some genes can mutate and they're mutating, I guess, all the time and nothing happens to you. On another case, one little thing could change and you could have a disease. I understand sickle cell anemia is, it just changes one little base pair of, I forget which one, one of these. That's all it takes. Or on the other hand, you could have all kinds of mutations end up again. Okay, and here was for those of you who need to see the score, there we have the start codons and then everything through to the end codons. And these are just three of those. So, it's reading them at different rates according to what they are, and it builds a piece of music. And of course, the tempo is arbitrary. I picked the tempo for this one. Okay. One day, my colleague, Dr. Strom, called me and said, "Peter, we just got invited to give the after dinner speech at the American chapter of at the Chicago chapter of the American Gynecological Association. They're having dinner on the Stager Orchestra Hall." I've only played there once before this. He said, "We can do the music." I said, "Great, well, what time should we show up?" He said, "Oh, I'm out of town, I can't go. You're gonna have to do it, you can do it." And I said, "What am I gonna do with these gynecologists? What am I gonna tell them? I can't really explain the science." He said, "Don't worry about it, you'll be fine. So, I thought, well, what would I play for a room full of gynecologists? And I said, well, something they don't hear a lot, which would be testosterone, right? So here we have this part, and then it's we can. And this is it. This is the dihydrotestosterone. I did this one. An early mix. You can see how early the idea of the mixer is, was early. I revised it many times since. And this particular mixer, I was asked again by a colleague of mine at the Art Institute who was curating an art show in Gary, Indiana, at the University in Gary, for the Miss Universe pageant that we know Trump was. Trump's thing there was doing in this Universe pageant. And so she said,
Well, what I'm going to do, if I'm doing this at the time of Miss Universe pageant, I want all male stuff. So all the artists were dealing with male and various, various sexual orientation things in there. And she said, Peter, can you do something? So I said, well, I called my friend Dr. Strom, and I said, give me the jeans, you know. So we got these, and as I think some of you know or may not know, an embryo, if it is resistant to testosterone or some of these male genes, defaults to a female. So you can have, for instance, in testicular feminization, which is rare, but it exists, you can have a female with XY chromosomes who was born with testicles that don't descend and then they're taken out, but they don't have reproductive organs, but they have everything else that a female has. But no uterus, but they have all the parts, but no uterus and no. Okay, so this, and they tend to be oddly paired with voluptuous. I didn't realize it. I didn't know that there were also triple X, that there were all these different variations of chromosome combinations. So for that exhibit, I put this up. You know, and again, it would kind of like a jukebox unless you played with it your own, and then you could also suggest one. This is Lori Andrews, who is in town. She is one of the preeminent bioethics lawyers, attorneys. She's at Kent Law School, teaching at Kent Law School. She also was an author. So she's written several novels. This is one, which is called Immunity, and it's based on some crime. And part of the solving of the crime involved they found the dengue fever, which is a fever, but primarily what in the tropics, Indian stuff. So she happened to call me and said, you know, Peter, you read my book, and so I said, really? And she said, well, yeah, we had them. We came over to your lab in at the Art Institute, and I said, did you use my name? She goes, yeah, they will use me. I don't know what you're for, and she said, we went there and we you played the dengue fever for us, and it was a chilling composition. And what I pointed out, well, you know, the reason why I do both diseases and genes tissue are that there's really no a disease, the gene of a disease does not by its definition sound menacing by any means. You can't make that assumption. So some of them sound particularly really interesting, some not. So I imagine if you did a visual thing, that would be also pretty interesting. So there are two more things, and then I'm actually done. One of the things, I was a Rockefeller fellow at Bellagio, Italy, which is a fabulous, some of you may have been there, it's a fabulous place to work. They let you work for a month, uninterrupted. They feed you. You spend the first 3 days looking out the window because it's so gorgeous, but then you realize that kind of work, you know, so you work. So I did this, my friend said, why don't we do the immunoglobulin system? Well, you know how the immune system works? You get a disease like a cold or chickenpox, you know. Chickenpox is a little different, obviously, because of shingles. But you get a disease, and there are all these immunoglobulin genes, billions of them, floating around. And then when one of them finds that disease that it can, wipe out or whatever, then the brain signals to make more of those things. And then what happens is that they go is that the I think the bone marrow they reside in the bone marrow, which keeps you immune for the rest of life. So you say, I got another cold. Well, there's so many different rhinoviruses. You can get many colds, but you apparently never get the same cold twice, even though you think you have, I guess. Okay. So the way the immunoglobulin genes work, which is very interesting because I'm using the computer, and I used to do a lot of work. I do a lot of work with probabilities, and to use probabilities, you've got to use a random generator. You have to weigh it and stuff. You have to do figure out ways to make, like you can do Markov chains, you could do a roll of dice probabilities, you can do anything. But you need to start with a random generator. The way these genes work is there are four what we call start parts of the gene headers, if you will. Lambda, gamma, kappa, lambda, gamma, kappa, and I'm missing one here. Just three, I'm sorry. It's been a while. And then there are variations of it. And those header genes are there. They're constant. But then your body will randomly generate the rest of the gene until it comes to a stop codon. So you can see that there are all these randomly generated genes in your body, and so what I did was, that's what I did. I mean, when it starts with the header, it generates the rest. When it reaches the stop codon, it's done. And we just have these things repeating and repeating, okay? So the immunoglobulin one then will play very much like the other mixer, okay? And
I'll just play briefly. This is a mix of all of them together. And so the point is,
my point being, this could go on for the rest of the world, the rest of our lives, because this is happening all the time. So this is a good piece for installation, where it just keeps going. And then again, the user can come up and mix and match it, or play the presets.
Sort of like, an electronic keyboard where you could play the presets, or if it's a synthesizer, you can make your own stuff. Okay, and finally, I will talk very briefly about lately, I've been thinking, what do these things sound like on piano? So I have a newer thing called DNA piano, for the DNA piano. And I'm thinking, well, gee, we have all these things happening at all these crazy times. It's like a polyphony in our bodies, right? And so some of these are going to be actual musical structures, like cannons. A cannon is like your boat, but a little more complex. And then there's what's called the mensuration cannons, where the voices come in staggered, but they're at different, the note values are different, and prolation cannons, where the meters are different and staggering. And then we have regular. So here I have a bunch of the, here's Botox Sank, which means five voices. The way in the medieval and Renaissance Georgia was nodding, they would say for the chanson Sank, five voices, okay? So Botox are five voices, which is the botulinum toxin bacteria. Chopin's Catarrh, again, we found out that he had cystic fibrosis. The piece that Peter referred to, what I did was I took the cystic fibrosis gene, translated the notes, then I went through the nocturnes and circled all those notes, and I did a performance of it. I went through all the nocturnes, but I didn't go through the whole, each individual nocturne, and played that with emphasizing the cystic fibrosis notes. And then we have the botch. This is the same one, but it's a cannon. This is collagen. What collagen is, it's in the the joints. And this is, of course, the plague. I did the plague for a musician in Chicago asked me if I could do a piece for or oboe or over the Mori, I think it was. And she said, you do the plague. So I did the plague. But this plague is, you can see in Italian, pianoforte la mano destra. There's a famous thing about a left-handed pianist. There's a history of left-handed pianists who lost their, one particularly famous one who lost his right arm. I said, well, I don't know if there's any music for right-handed pianists. So this is the plague for right-handed pianists. And this is a prolation canon. This is a special fancy imitative canon for five voices. This one, I think, may actually be playable. These other ones sound a little bit pointillistic, for those of you in music, George. A little bit like Brulez's Structuris, you know. It's almost as if the Kantarsky brothers there, the two that they play his music. So maybe Brulez knew something we didn't, but they sound a little bit like that. So let me, and then, of course, this you could put out. I ran this, the MIDI file from this through Sibelius and came out with the score. This is, needs touching up a lot, but nonetheless, these notes together, because they're very fast, they're arranged very fast next to each other. So, let's see, that's it for that. I'm going to just play a little bit of that for you, and I will, that'll be it. So let's, now, what I'm using here for the piano is this the fabulous program from France. In order to do to simulate instruments before, you would have to take samples. And to do a piano well, you might take a sample every three notes or something, and it'd be a huge amount of disk space that it'd take up. This is this French company that does it all algorithmically, and you could, I mean, it's amazing what you can do. You can detune each string like a good tuner will do, and you know, it's crazy stuff. And I think there's a whole bunch of pianos and harpsichords of Beethoven's Graf piano from 1826. They synthesize all of these things. It sounds fantastic. I think I'm using the Steinway D4 here,
which is the concert grand. And let's go ahead. And there's the DNA piano. And hopefully, let me just check the pitches. We gotta go back sorry, I have to go back to this and make sure that everything HDMI, that's good. Make sure we're good here. This stuff, unfortunately, as you move around, this stuff changes. This is it keeps going back to default. That's good. Oh, am I too soft? No. Let me go. I may have to forego this, which is a shame, because this is, I really wanted you to hear how fabulous this piano sounds. Let's go here again. There must be some input issue, because this is all set to go. Well, anyway, sorry about that. I don't know why it suddenly is not playing. Everything looks right. No, okay. Anyway, you see what happens here. You see the actual pitches as they play in this can, and then this one. You would see them, and so play here, and the palate goes up and down accordingly. I'm sorry about that. I don't know, it was working fine. So I don't know why it's sort of mixing back and forth that causes the issue. I'm gonna get rid of this or this.
You know what, we'll keep moving. What we'll try to do is we'll get it working for the closing. So we'll have
Q&A
so people can hear.
Yeah, it doesn't make a difference. Okay, yeah. I don't want to hold anything up. So let's call that out, bring the computer.
All right. Thank you so much. do our best to get that up and running at the very end here. So, Christian Bök, contrary to his name, is a text that's unbounded by covers. Here at DePaul, the nation's largest Catholic university, you might have reasonable grounds to think that if I'm introducing you to the Christian Bök, that a copy of the New Testament might soon lumber up to the podium. While the poet you'll meet in just a moment does not have all of his sacred dialogue printed in red ink, the work that he does is wholly interesting and original. Christian is Associate Professor of English at the University of Calgary, where he regularly teaches courses in creative writing, poetry, contemporary experimental poetics, science fiction and speculative fiction, contemporary Canadian writing, and contemporary literary theory. He's the author of the aforementioned Christology and Yenoya, as well as 2001's Pataphysics, The Poetics of an Imaginary Science, and last year's The Xenotext, about which we'll be hearing more in a moment. I make it a habit to read everything, or at least close to everything, that our guests to the DePaul Humanities Center have published, and I was overjoyed when I discovered that the first official publication that I could dig up by Christian was actually a three-page article in Dragon, the official magazine of Dungeons and Dragons. Now, as someone who once spent countless hours reading this magazine, and I mean, as someone who had a friend who once spent countless hours reading the magazine and playing D&D, I really was excited and overjoyed when I discovered this. And here, even as it borders on juvenilia, are hints of the author we know today. As Christian describes the contents of a book of spells conjured by an evil sorcerer named Azirian, with the book's cover of thin obsidian bearing no title other than phantom images that sometimes appear and quickly vanish, and the first page of the book having a magic mouth that speaks a warning in a foreign language that causes the hearer and the reader to contract a rotting disease similar to the leprous touch of a mummy, unless he or she makes a saving throw versus death magic, of course. As I suggested earlier, Christian is most interested in investigating language by putting it in extreme test conditions, discovering that even while refraining from the use of the easy trappings of his tradition, beauty can emerge from stress. This is a path few follow. There are some fellow experimental poets, but I find it interesting to think about the connections that emerge elsewhere. James Joyce Finnegan's Wake is a distant relative and surely an example of language under stress, but in some ways, Joyce was experimenting by putting fewer constraints on himself and his work rather than more. Hemingway, perhaps, is a kissing cousin, at least in a story such as Hills Like White Elephants, in which he seems to be challenging himself to write without any adverbs at all. Indeed, the single adverb that the narrator allows himself that's not part of the dialogue between the man and the woman in the story comes at the very end, when the man notices all of the people waiting reasonably for the train. And the force of this one word smacking the reader upside the head with its sudden adverbiness carries much more narrative weight precisely because it stands alone, because of the restrictions. Hemingway was a compassionate writer, a compassionate man. But in stressing the language as he did, we discover something special about how language works. In truth, Hemingway was not known to limit himself much in any way, apart from his sparing use of descriptive parts of speech. In life, he was something of a hedonist. His was a movable feast, but when he ate, he did not eat abstemiously. But truly, Christian is following the far smarter path, one requiring more patience and, I think, more real talent. Hemingway lived to wrestle other writers to the ground, to exert his power by celebrating the killing of bulls in his life and his work. Christian is aware of the animal power of language, but is calming and understanding it by forcing it to extremes. Language, this wild, horned beast, falls under the power of the great poet tamer. Christian cracks his whip and shouts, "Back, rhino, sit!" And the majestic beast stops, falls to the ground, and gives up its secrets, still alive, still ready to keep on writing. In less than 6 billion years, the sun will expand into a red giant and engulf the earth. If Christian has his way, the last thing that any living being may be doing on this planet is writing poetry, at least at the level of its DNA. There's something classically romantic about this, but in a sterile way that's stripped of human emotion. And this makes sense in a world that will surely no longer have humans on it. It's no wonder that Christian is Canada's most celebrated poet. He's the winner of the Canadian Griffith Poetry Prize and the voice of contemporary experimental poetry in this country. Poet, scientist, purveyor of tragedy, writer of comedy, an artistic colony contently composed of quadrillions of cells working to make him up, Christian Bök has the sort of mind we're fortunate to welcome to our community this evening. You know, the golden album aboard the Voyager space probe that was launched from Earth in 1977 contained on it messages written to be discovered by alien civilizations. With music, photographs, and greetings in dozens of Earth languages, the album was meant as our extraterrestrial calling card. But what few people mention is that there is likely some form of Earth life on board that probe as well. Microbes that are in the same family as the ones that Christian is bioengineering today are the sort of extremophile life forms that could withstand centuries in the vacuum of space, surviving long enough to be discovered by an alien scientist on some distant planet. How wonderful it is to speculatively imagine some parallel world on which Christian had been born just a bit earlier, able to work on the Voyager mission, bioengineering a poetic greeting into the DNA of these small passengers on board the spacecraft. How wonderful it is to imagine that distant aliens might look into this Earth life form for a clue, a message in its genes, something to sum up humans in just a line of poetry, only to unlock the code and begin reading, "There once was a microbe from Nantucket." Friends, I am very pleased to introduce to you the incredibly talented Baron Shtick I, a 19th level half-elf sorcerer able to cast a mean Crimson Scourge spell, the Legion, the scientist, celebrated experimental poet, Professor Christian Bök.
I'm going to talk to you today about a project that is still in progress. I've been working on it now for 15 years, a project entitled the Xenotext. I should note that my presentation is sufficiently pretentious enough to have an epigraph. This one is from F.T. Marinetti in his Technical Manifesto of Futurist Literature. There is also a microbe essential to the vitality of art, and I'd like to talk with you for a little while about such a microbe. The Xenotext is a kind of experiment, a literary exercise that explores the aesthetic potential of genetics in the modern milieu, doing so in order to make literal the renowned aphorism of William S. Burroughs, who has declared that the word is now a virus. My experiment proposes to address some of the sociological implications of biotechnology by manufacturing a xenotext, a beautiful, anomalous poem whose alien words might subsist like a harmless parasite inside the cell of another life form. I have composed my own example of living poetry, so that when translated into a gene and then integrated into the cell, the text nevertheless gets expressed by the organism, which, in response to this grafted genetic sequence, begins to manufacture a viable, benign protein, one that, according to the original chemical alphabet, is itself yet another text. I am, in effect, engineering a primitive bacterium so that it becomes not only a durable archive for storing a poem, but also an operant machine for writing a poem. Let me introduce you to the host organism. This is Deinococcus radiodurans. It is the proposed symbiote for my xenotext. In part because this extremophile can repair its DNA so quickly that the germ resists mutation, and for this reason, it is an evolutionary dead end. But let me tell you that it is already so well adapted to the utter lethality of the universe that it really does not need to change very much at all. Scorch it, freeze it, wither it, and still it endures. It can survive exposure to the vacuum of outer space. It can withstand dosages of gamma rays 1,000 times more lethal than the dosage needed to obliterate a human being. A few biologists, including Anatoly K. Pavlov and others, have argued, somewhat extravagantly, that the ancestor of this organism might have been extraterrestrial in origin in order to have acquired all of these environmental immunities. Let me tell you a little bit about the poem. This poem took me 4 years to write, and I did not do anything else for 4 years. Because there exists a codependent biochemical relationship between any preliminary genetic sequence and its resulting protein sequence, my two poems must likewise be bijective in their structure. Imagine pairing off all the letters of the alphabet so that they're mutually assigned to each other. So if I pick A and I assign it to the letter T, I have to assign the letter T to the letter A. If I assign the letter H to the letter N, I have to assign N to the letter H. At the top of the screen, you can actually see these letters paired off so that they're mutually correlated. Now imagine doing this, knowing that there are 7,905,853,580,625 possibilities for such encipherments, a little less than 8 trillion options at your disposal. Pick one. Now write an eloquent poem such that if we replace every single letter with its counterpart from this code, we get yet another eloquent poem. After nearly 4 years of failure trying to write two intelligible texts according to this very burdensome constraint, I've nevertheless made the prerequisite breakthrough, and here are the two poems. I might note that what freaks people out when they first look at these poems is that wherever you might see an A in one poem, you'll see a T in the other, and vice versa. Wherever you see an N in one poem, there'll be an H in the other, and vice versa. Wherever you see a Y in one poem, you'll see an E in the other, and vice versa. The two poems mutually transpose their letters perfectly. The first poem on the left, I've nicknamed Orpheus. That's the poem by me, and it reads, "Any style of life is prim. Oh, stay, my lyre, with wily ploys moan the riff of any tune allowed. Moan now my fate. In fate we rely. My myth now is the word of life." Now, the organism has this poem enciphered into its genome. And in response, it reads it and produces a protein whose sequence of amino acids encipher the poem on the right, a poem that I've nicknamed Eurydice. And this poem, written by the organism in response, reads, "The fairy is rosy of glow. In fate we rely. Moan more grief with any loss. Any loss is the achy trick. With him we stay. Oh, stay, my lyre. We wean him of any milk. Any milk is rosy." The text on the left is written by me as a masculine assertion about the aesthetic creation of life, while the text on the right is written by the microbe as a kind of feminine refutation about the woebegone absence of life. The two poems resemble Petrarchan sonnets, in dialogue with each other, much like poems written in the elegiac paschal tradition of the herd boy and the nymphette. Moreover, the protein that enciphers the poem by the microbe has been chemically tagged so as to make the cell glow red in the dark. The microbe is in effect going to fluoresce rubescently in a fey way that embodies the rosiness attributed to the fairy described within the content of the poem itself. You know that this microbe is writing its poem because it actually glows red in the dark, becoming this fairy that is in fact rosy of glow. Here you can actually see it glowing in the petri dish in one of my laboratories. On March 31st in 2011, my lab at the University of Calgary confirmed that the gene XP13 caused a colony of E. coli to fluoresce red in our test runs, implying that when implanted into the genome of this bacterium, my poem caused the cell to write its own poem in response. However, later tests showed that the protein was only half as massive as expected, implying that the germ was censoring my poem, destroying it during expression. I received a lot of attention for purportedly succeeding at this project, but then had to retract my results because I had, in effect, engineered not the first microbial writer, but the first microbial critic. On October 3rd in 2012, after months of failed assays, I finally received confirmation from my lab at DNA 2.0 that a revised genetic cipher entitled gene XP13-4A did cause its culture of E. coli to fluoresce properly without destroying the poetic matter of the protein. So I can now say that I'm the first person in history to design a microorganism capable of writing a meaningful text in response to an enciphered gene. I have since collaborated with a lab at the University of Wyoming in order to implant this gene into Deinococcus radiodurans. Now, in this particular image, the dark blot in the second lane from the left actually signals the presence of the poem in E. coli. That's the verifying swatch from this electrophoresis gel. This image is the backbone of the resulting protein after 2 femtoseconds of folding. The image depicts what the poem is expected to look like at the atomic level in the cell. It's a simulation of the protein fold that the organism would end up producing in response to the gene sequence. And here you can actually see the molecular embodiment of the xenotext as a kind of sculptural translation of the poem itself. This is in fact a model made out of toy molecules for exhibit in a gallery. This in fact is the poem that begins, "The fairy is rosy of glow," just actually embodied as a sculptural model. And to date, this sculpture has appeared at 4 different venues, the Bury Art Gallery in Manchester, the Museum of Contemporary Art in Denver, the Power Plant in Toronto, and the Block Museum in Lansing, mostly as part of an exhibition entitled "Postscript: Writing After Conceptual Art," a retrospective about current schools of conceptual writing, of which I'm one of the founding members. On October 31st in 2013, after months of detailed planning, I received word from my lab at the University of Wyoming that the implantation of the xenotext into Deinococcus radiodurans had achieved 2 of my 3 benchmarks for success. First, the organism had fully integrated the plasmid for the gene into its chromosome, meaning that the gene would endure in the cell. The scientists were actually very impressed that I managed to accomplish this particular feat. And second, the organism was, in fact, fluorescing red in response to the gene, meaning that the cell was constructing the protein according to our expectations. The technicians, however, could not detect the full mass of the protein, arguing that the organism was metabolizing the construct too quickly for their methods of detection. Nevertheless, the scientists thought that they were actually conveying good news about my success, when, of course, these results implied that, as in the case of the failed assays for E. coli, the extremophile was, in fact, destroying the poetic matter of the text before we could read it, meaning that no one could, of course, verify the poetic merits of the microbe. And here you have a picture depicting the failed sample culture of my synthetic bacterium. Alas, I found out this result on the very last day of my funding, when all the budgetary contracts expired, exhausting all my resources and all my expertise. I had spent more than $120,000 Canadian over the course of 5 years on this project, only to fail after a photo finish, stalling out within sight of my finish lines, really bereft of any hypotheses about the reasons for this failure. And consequently, I've now set out to raise more funds to rebuild my team so that I can resolve these issues in the hope that I can make the poem work. I should note that I do not think at any time in the history of contemporary poetry has any poet ever received a $150,000 advance for a book of poetry. I can say that I've received that much money to write a book of poetry. I'm sure I'm not going to earn out that advance. I will also note that just a couple of days ago, I actually submitted an essay to try again, and I should know, I think, within the next 4 to 8 weeks whether or not I'm successful. But I think this slide actually depicts my sentiment at the time, that I really felt that I had to make every desperate effort to succeed at this project, because of course, among poets, failure is always presumed. The Xenotext ultimately infects the language of genetics with the poetic vectors of its own discourse, doing so in order to show that through the use of such biological emissaries, we might transmit messages across stellar distances or even epochal intervals. Unlike any other cultural artifacts so far produced, except perhaps for the Pioneer probes or the Voyager probes, my poem, stored inside the genome of a bacterium, might conceivably testify to our presence upon the planet until the very hour when at last the sun itself explodes. I'm striving, in effect, to produce an immortal artifact in the face of our own extinction. Here you actually have a slide depicting one of my certificates of participation in a variety of projects associated with the Xenotext. Because even now, a copy of the poem has hitched a ride aboard not only the OSIRIS-REx probe en route to the asteroid Bennu, but also the MAVEN probe in orbit around the planet Mars. The poem is actually a part of the digital payload aboard the MAVEN probe. Moreover, a radio telescope at the James Berg Earth Station in Carmel, California, has beamed a copy of the Xenotext to the exoplanet Gliese 526 in the constellation Boötes as part of a plan to communicate with any civilization that might reside on this allegedly habitable world orbiting in the Goldilocks zone of its red dwarf star. As you can see, I'm in effect striving to create an imaginary solution to many of the requisite problems that poetry itself faces on the eve of its own demise. When people remark to me about the death of poetry, my response is to build an unkillable poem. Of course, a demise already upstaged in advance by our other cultural concerns, more epic than any poem. What I'd like to do for you now is actually perform an excerpt from my current book, the first half of this project published. This is from the Xenotext Book 1, and I'm just going to read to you the opening salvo, the opening poem. This poem is entitled The Late Heavy Bombardment. Welcome, wraith and reader, to the Hadean Aeon of the Earth. When myrmidons hurled their cobalt bombs into your molten world of basalt and bronze, when mighty golems swan dove from orbit to drive their glaives of iron into your black mesas, only to be engulfed by the blast waves, when meteors fell earthward in droves, each one a gigaton warhead ablaze, when supervolcanoes erupted phlegmovomous after each hammer blow from these endless blitzes of aerolites and firebombs, when bolides of brimstone collided, then exploded into ablative cascades, when tsunamis of lava like napalm bedrowned a subcontinent in a deluge of flames, when millions of Molotov cocktails shattered all at once upon the cobblestones of hell, when Trojans berserk with rage stormed over the brink of your abyss, vowing to claw your face from the skull of the moon. What dire seed must these onslaughts have scattered like shrapnel across your cremated badlands? What prion, what virus, what breed of spore must have emerged like a spear point or a sword blade from these early ovens of Auschwitz each cyanide bonfire burning in reverse, spitting forth a fitful embryo cloned from the smoke and the dross. What orchid must have bloomed among the flamethrowers in the furnace? What dragon must have hatched from a burnt geode buried in these ashes? Must the universe be so pitiless as to immolate all its offspring at birth? Even now, the astronauts have marshaled their forces to march resolute across the kill zone of your god-forsaken crematorium. Even now, they forge ahead onward through war games of wildfire, unaware that far away a doomsayer murmurs prayers against them from a fiendish grimoire. What howl can beckon from the benthic fathoms of your damnation so alien a ghoul as Vampirotuthis infernalis, the vampire squid from hell, a maw that can hurl itself at your soul like an overcloak cast upon a coat hook in the dark? What does such a black brain afloat in its vat of ink know about the death blows to your planet? What does such an emissary think about the pageant of living things that go extinct en route to your incinerators? The trilobites, the nautilites, the gorgosaurs, the pterosaurs, the iguanodons, the megalodons, all of them massacred but unmourned. All the deepest seas have withered and soured. All the tallest alps have crumbled and burned. You have choked on miasmas of methane. You have upturned all your braziers, spilling embers across the flagstones. All your fossils have dissolved in a flash flood of acid rain. What great comet has yet to plummet from the heavens like a rocket engine, dousing its jets during splashdown in your oceans of nitroglycerin? What thunderclap has yet to herald the advent of this plowshare, which can bulldoze a mountain into rubble upon impact? What matchheads, when scraped against your atmosphere, can ignite its oxygen, turning the sky into a blazing typhoon? Only a demigod like 99942 Apophis can offer you this apocalypse by becoming the juggernaut that smashes through the massive bulwark of your bedrock. Only destroyers like 2102 Tantalus or 4179 Tatis can erase all Earthlings with the ease of suicide bombers at a marketplace. Can an oyster in its shell survive the inferno of free fall from outer space? Can a crocus thrive in soil made from pulverized meteorites? All hail, hail Bop, and every super bomb yet to detonate. What great dying must the earth foresee in the barren mirror of the moon? What fate, what fury, what muse must gaze upon the grim face of grief reflected in your silver shield, a faceplate of bulletproof glass, pitted and strewn with scars? What cinders aflame disintegrate in your gray seas of nectar, of vapor, of crisis? What shell shock must greet you when you stumble aghast upon the charred remains of a forest at Tunguska, its evergreens toppled and blasted, all of them split like matchsticks? What crater among the lunar Maria must you yearn to recreate whenever you vaporize an atoll? Even now, your battalions of astronauts stride across green plains of trinitite, to storm the walls of Castle Bravo and Castle Romeo. Even now, Neil Armstrong returns like Orpheus to the airlock, his spacesuit reeking of gunpowder and burnt steel. What American falconer must aviate your spy plane by the stray light of meteor storms from the Draconids or the Scorpids, the flak raining down like glitter dust upon the desert during a nocturnal firefight? What scythe blades must the Vikings forge from the wreckage of an asteroid recovered from Cape York? What archangel must the martyrs placate when they kiss the black stone of the Kaaba at Mecca during the Hajj? What sunburst must erupt like Krakatoa over the Arctic Circle when the firepower of your payload exceeds by tenfold all the dynamite exploded during World War II? Even now, the President of the United States sits alone at night, dreading the grim hour when he must open the memo from his aide, only to read upon the page the single phrase, "Pinnacle nuke flash," the news flash that chronicles the omnicide of the world. What global threat of Sturm und Drang must your armies yet endure? Even in their granite bunkers, deep beneath the massif of Cheyenne Mountain, when every fountain of hellfire in the firmament can destroy you, when a K-dwarf star like Gliese 710 can plow through the Oort cloud, bombarding the Earth with cometoids that shatter every landmass, when a wolf rayet star like WR-104 can outshine the galaxy in a burst of gamma rays so bright that the blaze must burn away the ozone layer, when the sun itself can bloat then flare to engulf you in a flaming embrace that atomizes the iron core of your planet. Even now, your astronauts are running out of air while they writhe inside their blazing coffins. Even now, you must despair, for you have listened to the throb of the universe, yet you do not hear the cries of any other souls in hell. Tell me, Wraith and Reader, tell me, will love save us from our fear that we are here alone? What then if we peer into the sky at night, but see no distant lantern blinking at us from the far end of the cosmos? What if such a beacon goes unnoticed, like a dying flame in the darkness? What if only the most wicked people in the world, the pharaohs, the warlocks, the assassins, ever get to read this signal from outer space? What if the message, when decoded, says nothing but a single phrase repeated? We despise you. We despise you. What if we find the evidence for such hate embedded in our genomes? Even now, colonies of dark ants from a species called Mystrium Shadow feed themselves upon the blood of their young. Even now, my love, these words confess to you that the universe, without you in it, is but a merciless explosion. Come with me, and let me show you how to break my heart. Thank you.
Wow, that was a heavy bump.
bombardment of poetry there. That was amazing. Thank you so much. I know that we're a bit over, but I just can't miss this opportunity to get everybody together to have a little bit of questioning from you as well. So if you can stay with us, please, for just 10, 15 minutes, we'd like to do that and hopefully get a chance to play Peter's music as well. I'd like to invite Jonathan, Peter, and Christian to come back on stage with me and have a seat here for a moment, and we're going to do just a little bit of Q&A. And while we're getting ready for that, just want to invite any of our panelists to, if they have any questions for each other or any comments after hearing each other's presentations, to get started.
You chose Deinococcus radiodurans because it can survive in outer space. Things that go into outer space have to survive radiation, but they also survive as freeze-dried organisms because it's vacuum and it's dry. I've worked a lot with Deinococcus radiodurans. It's a really interesting organism. There are lots of other microbes that can survive in space provided they get buried inside even other dead organisms. Have you thought about using other things besides? Deinococcus is a bit of a problem to transform. There's lots of organisms that are easier to transform that you could encapsulate that would last as well.
Part of the reason I chose that particular organism, though, is that it repairs its own DNA so quickly that it resists mutational drift. I wanted, of course, the organism to preserve the polar tree. And unless I can actually design a protein that augments the survivability of the organism, which is, of course, a super added constraint that would be too difficult, I think, to realize. I have to actually pick something that will preserve the information against the effects of evolution, at least for a prolonged period of time. Obviously, evolutionary drift will exert its influence over the organism, but it's really resistant to those kinds of changes because it can repair its own DNA. If I use some other bacterium, it wouldn't necessarily have this head against its disappearance. But you're right, I mean, there's lots of organisms I could have chosen, and honestly, I wish I had simply promised to fulfill this project in the matrix of E. coli, because then I'd be done. I could say I'm finished.
So there's one other thing that molecular biologists do, is that they force the hand of the organism by putting the gene of interest in the context of something that if the organism doesn't do that, it dies. So, example, an antibiotic-resistant gene is used, and if it doesn't maintain that gene when you grow it in the presence of the antibiotic, it would die. Have you considered something that would be a selective pressure to keep your organism from rejecting your poetry or editing it?
It's true. I've considered doing that, of course, adding other kinds of genetic constructs to the sequence itself to improve its survivability. The challenge, of course, is that the longer the protein gets, the more complicated its fold becomes, and the greater the likelihood that the ribosome might actually censor it or destroy it, chew it up. I've just not been able to find a way of burying it in the midst of some other protein construct so that it would persist. In my experience, at least trying to engineer an organism really resistant to engineering, like Deinococcus radiodurans, I think if I do something shorter, smaller, more compact, then they have a better chance of producing a fold that's more viable.
Have you considered doing what you're trying to do in a virus rather than in a living organism and then going and infecting the organisms that would come up in the future that would then replicate?
Also thought of doing that too. again, I actually don't have a sufficient amount of dilatantish immersion in viroidal structure that I could actually build something that would work. I think I'm making use of the resources I have at my disposal, the expertise I have at my disposal. But of course, I have thought about that. I've actually wondered if it would be easier simply to put it in a viroidal structure and see about preserving it by infecting other organisms. I've certainly thought about that. I always think that these are going to be like phase 3 or phase 4 of the project, that I would try something else if I was able to succeed.
Could I ask one more question? Have you considered discovering poetry rather than writing poetry?
Yes, I have.
There's a huge amount of stuff that's random and a lot of almost nonsense codon within the genomes of organisms. Maybe the poems are hidden there at that range.
The astrophysicist Paul Davies has speculated that one of the most efficient ways to transmit messages across stellar distances would in fact be encipherment in genomes of viruses and spores. And he speculates that perhaps even now in our own ecology there may in fact be an alien message from outer space buried somewhere in the genetic lexicons of organisms that we haven't yet detected. I might note that in the 1970s, the very first virus whose genome was sequenced, done by Frederick Sanger, won the Nobel Prize for it. Its genome was considered so efficient that it was at first thought to be artificial. And there are published journal articles in the 1970s by scientists who were trying to see if it might actually decipher a message from outer space. They're great articles, they're really wonderful articles. I've actually taken that genetic sequence and seen if it's possible to actually try and decipher it into a meaningful text to see if there's poetry in it somewhere, as an exercise. So yes, I've actually considered looking for, you know, poetic messages in other organisms, trying to find inventive ways of deciphering them so that you come up with a pataphysical message that is a way of recognizing maybe a face in the moon or something, and you're just accidentally finding a message and attributing significance to it.
But if you and Peter got together, you could just write code that translates the message into something meaningful.
Yeah, that would be the interesting thing to do then, would be to come up with some algorithm that would make it possible to impose a message on this otherwise random sequence of codons.
Not random.
But yes, you understand what I mean.
Such a science fiction trope, isn't it? That I remember at the end of Star Trek The Next Generation, maybe the last season, when they got together and found a message hidden in the DNA of humans, Klingons, Romulans. It was supposed to explain why they all sort of looked the same, and not just that they had to hire human actors for the show, but it explained that, but there was also a message there. And then of course the alien slide was hilarious, Christian, but the alien movie, I guess there are four or five now if we count Prometheus, with Prometheus having that built into the film, the idea that there is some sort of message built into the genome, but it turns out that it's not really from God. It may be from a race of creatures that hates us, that despises us, as you say at the end of it.
I found that episode of Star Trek pretty interesting. I thought it was a great premise. Unfortunately, the message they discover is very dull. It's a message of fellowship and universal brotherhood. And it's quite boring, actually. Like, we'd like to think that the message you might find in a genetic sequence would be more edifying.
This is the way the world is, not with a bang, but a whimper.
Something like that. Perhaps we should ask people in the audience if they have questions they might like to
ask. Please go ahead, George.
It occurs to me to ask this question, I'm not sure how to word it, whether it is possible for Peter to somehow use his music to be influenced by the poetry of Christian, such that, not necessarily that it's set, the poetry is set, but somehow reflected or generated in some molecular or genetic way.
I could certainly give Peter my genetic sequence and he would be undoubtedly able to translate it into a piece of music. I mean, that would seem to me before something I should do, right?
Sure. I don't know, I had this thought about what you're doing, Christian, and the only, it is sort of like a certain amount, there's a certain amount of semiotics of that. Now the only thing I did with that was the Chopin, the cystic fibrosis gene, and I looked for the notes in the music as if there was some underlying aspect to it, in a semiotic sense, underlying aspect of his disease and his oeuvre. And I was hoping to do more than just the nocturnes. I don't know about the will. It's too much music, but I like the idea. I think it's just brilliant what you're doing, and I commend you. 4 years. Can I ask, with that system where it took 4 years to do a poem, would it take 4 years to do another one? Or how many?
Well, there are eight trillion possibilities.
Well, I know, but
and
it's the same system.
I explored most of those 8 trillion possibilities. I found the largest vocabulary I found was about 780 words. I worked my way through vocabularies that were very large, progressively through ones that were smaller, none of which could actually produce mutually inseparable
texts. But the one you chose, in the pairings you chose, you couldn't
could find another poem, is what I'm asking. It must be difficult.
Of those pairing of that particular of that particular cipher, no, that's the best poem I could get written. That's those great. That particular vocabulary is quite limited. It's only 120 words. I was beginning to work through very small vocabularies, worried that in fact I would not be able to find a lexicon capable of writing two poems.
Have you tried another language besides English?
Well, I speak two languages very badly, English and French. It's already hard enough to do it in English. I would save that task for somebody who is a native speaker and wants to follow in my footsteps.
What about a binary?
I've never actually considered trying to do any other way except English. And of course, I leave those other options to people who might be sufficiently masochistic enough to do it for themselves. I mean, it took a tremendous amount of effort just to find this one poem out of 8 trillion possibilities. I mean, in effect, there's 8 trillion universes, none of which contain poetry. That's why I think these two poems are special. They're not the kinds of poems I typically write. They're somewhat fragile, but they're the only poems that exist out of 8 trillion universes. You know, out of 8 trillion possibilities, there's only one world that contains life. And I think that's what makes those texts meaningful to me.
We know we used to, in music, we used to marvel at the fact that with 12-tone music that Schubert devised, where you would combine the 12 pitches, but in a never-repeating sequence, that there were 400 million, 1600 possible combinations of 12-tone rows. And to go to 26 elements, that's unfathomable.
Think we have another question?
Yep. Hey. Thank you for the great presentations, everyone. I had a question for a book about translation, because that came up a lot. And it seemed like you were interested in almost like a pure translation of your poem into the protein. And forgive my limited understanding of how the science of it works, but for example, a pun is not going to work necessarily in translation between languages. So I'm wondering if in translating your poem into the protein, it made sense in that context or something. Is it possible for you to almost translate backwards from the failed attempt?
Well, the point of designing the poems, they have to be written in such a way or enciphered in such a way that the resultant protein folds properly and persists viably within the cell, that it's stable. In this respect, the poem fails if it's metabolized too quickly or if the organism refuses to make it, if the mass of the entire protein's not there. So in that respect, I'm actually in dialogue with the biochemical constraints of the biology itself. And in many cases, I have not figured out why some of the assays have not failed. According to the simulations we've done on computers, they all look like they should work, but of course they don't. And there's a bit of voodoo, I think, involved in proteomic engineering. In this respect, I'm interested in dialogue with the organism. I can't simply make it do what I want it to do. People have often said that there's some hubris in my attempt to make this microbe do my bidding, and I say it's the other way around. I'm doing its bidding. I'm actually constrained by it. It tells me what to do. And because it's like a little god, I have to appease it. I have to surrender all this treasure and hundreds of thousands of dollars and time and energy, right, to make it work. It's a very old organism. It's like smog, in its lair.
So, but Christian, let me interject. So if you put in if you have an organ transplant, which people do, the body is designed to reject foreign things.
Sure.
All microbes are designed, they protect themselves from viruses, for example,
sure,
by rejecting those proteins from viruses. But viruses have tricked them.
Yeah.
And we can trick our immune system and keep our implanted organs by depressing our immune system.
Sure.
And you could potentially try to find organisms that would host your poem.
Sure.
Rather than worrying about it being an extremophile, you can say, well, let's green thousands of organisms until we find one that is happy to have your poem be on.
That's true. That would require a very big grant. And I have to admit that I've already, I think, strained the patience of the Canadian taxpayer. But I mean, you're right. I could certainly do that. I just don't know who would pay for it. I think it's actually more challenging, though. Obviously, I'm the kind of person who adopts a challenge to get it to work in this particular organism. This particular one has a a kind of surreal poetic potential to it. If I had simply wanted to put it in any organism, I'd be successful by now, because I've actually gotten it to work definitively in E. coli, and that result is reproducible. But I didn't promise to do just that. If you promise to put a chimp in orbit, that's fine. You know, you're successful if you promise that. But I promised to put a chimp on the moon, so even though I've put it in orbit, nobody really cares. The amount of attention I've received for getting it to work in E. coli is modest compared to the attention I'm likely to get if I actually get it to work in the extremophile. You're right. There's problems of translation. I have to adopt the language of the organism and abide by its constraints. And in effect, it has all the power. It tells me what to do.
I have another question. To be completely irritating, I want you to comment on the historicity of your project, especially with relation to American conceptualists, because, forgive me, I don't know exactly what your relationship is with the American conceptual poets.
Well, I'm one of the founding members, so they're all my best friends.
Okay. So, for example, like your poetry that you just read, I thought it was excellent, and it was more interesting to me than some of the stuff that Kenneth Goldsmith is doing, where he kind of usurps trauma and then kind of makes it his own and claims ownership over it. So, I was struck by your wielding of this decaying language to do something very exciting. So, how do you see yourself in conversation with some of your...
Well, my friends among the conceptualists are interested in pushing language to its limit cases, the outer limits of what constitutes a definition of poetry, of writing. In Kenny's case, Kenny's my best friend, he's exploring the limits of the ready-made text, models of plagiarism as a value, a viable aesthetic value. In my case, it would be probably the mannerist text, the limit cases of a procedural constraint, doing things that look impossible because there are so many overriding rules that impede expression. But among my other friends, there's poets like Craig Dworkin or Derek Liu who pursue an interest in illegible forms of writing that are designed to be quite literally unreadable and test your willingness, I think, to engage with the text. And finally, and to me, probably the most important limit cases have to do with the creation of automatic forms of writing where machines do the work on our behalf. And I think that those are the most critically strange outcomes. I mean, computers are not getting stupider. They're very likely going to evolve in their intelligence much faster than ours. And I foresee that computers will end up writing poetry as well as any human being. And most of the books already on Amazon are written by machine, or at least collated by machines. I think that the future of writing is going to have to contend with these particular kinds of limit cases. And I'm just participating with one of those options among four that we typically pursue. So that's my relationship with that game. Yeah.
Thank you. We saw earlier that 5 to 6 billion years, the sun will swell and destroy the earth completely. And sometimes in my classes, at the end of a quarter, after we spend a long while reading philosophy together, I'll tell my students how everything's gonna die. I've rehearsed that story here on this stage before even. The death of the universe itself in about 10 to the 100th power years, the thermodynamic death of the universe. Nothing will survive. Such that even if we're capable of making some message appear in an extremophile life form, it won't last. But I think that if we want art to be about immortality, and if we want science to be about immortality, as far too often people misunderstand it to be, then we are wanting the impossible. Instead, I think that when we get really creative people doing really creative things, that there's something to celebrate in the moment of that. And it doesn't matter if the fairy is rosily glowing right now, it matters that we're doing this right now and that we're alive now. I'm very pleased that you were able to join us tonight, and please join me in thanking one last time Christian Bök, Jonathan Trent, and Peter Gena.
Thank you very much.